Ellen Lupton is a curator of graphic design at the Cooper Hewitt Smithsonian Design Museum in New York. She's also one of the founders of the graduate program in graphic design at MICA, the Maryland Institute of something. Well, how did, I'm not sure what the C, A is arts, I'm not sure what C is. College of Arts, Maryland Institute College of Arts, is that it? Yes, okay, there you go. Author of at least 6 or 8 books that I know about, but most notably Thinking with Type, which is a perennial favorite. And the note that she gave us is, I have 2 kids, I have 2 dogs, I live in 2 cities, and I have an identical twin sister. So this might not be me. Ellen Lupton.
Thank you. Okay, what do we got here? That's me. It is me, I promise. They know. Hi, I'm so excited to be here. What a beautiful room, what a beautiful city. I love being surrounded by books and print and ephemera and libraries, and just the weight of all that knowledge is really cool. I got to San Francisco on Saturday night. I spent all day with an amazing group of designers doing a workshop at the Letterform Archive on Sunday. I think I saw a couple of people from that here. I did research at the archive. You'll see some of the fruits of that in my talk. So it's just been super fun. Greetings from Cooper Hewitt. A little background about me. I went to art school in the early 80s at Cooper Union. And this is what graphic design looked like then. These are the tools that we used. Many of these tools are now illegal or obsolete. They deserve to be in a museum along with all the stuff at the Letterform Archive. When I got to school to use this stuff, I didn't like these tools. These were tools for neat people, and I'm not neat. I think I like to be funny, I like to write, I like to tell jokes, I like to read a lot, but I'm really not neat. So graphic design was really intimidating to me, partly because of these tools. But I fell in love with graphic design anyway, because I was excited about the link between language and visual art. That was like revolutionary to me and something I just had never thought about, never thought that was possible. And that was kind of the connection for me. So in the early 80s, when I was in the East Village at Cooper Union, there was artwork on the street by Jenny Holzer. And it was stuff like this, and it was just pasted onto the walls. It was little stickers stuck onto telephone poles. I think it was all like Times New Roman. I didn't care, really. And it was language and politics presented through typography in public. And I thought that was pretty great and pretty exciting. And a different model of what art could be, as well as an intriguing model about design being like authored and having its own voice. So these were amazing pieces, and she's a huge muse and influence and, you know, guiding spirit for many of us. This is one of the books that we had to read back at Cooper at the time. And so this was kind of the opposite, right? So Jenny Holzer was on the street being very political. And very language-oriented. And then we had books like Joseph Moeller Brockman, The Graphic Designer and His Design Problems, which were very rule-oriented and about creating social order, you know, creating a better world through Helvetica and grids. I thought that was pretty cool, too. You know, these were all new, interesting, exciting ideas. So this is the kind of book we read in class, in design class. But these are the books that I was reading outside of class. And I still have all these books. They're like on a shelf in my house. They're called Books I Read in College. And these books really affected me. And they were about language and philosophy and politics. And often making a connection to graphic design through the idea of the materiality of speech, the materiality of language. But they were sort of saying something completely different from what we were learning in school. And they made me question some of the normativity and rule-based attitude of graphic design, even while I kind of love the rules, you know? So, you know, these conflicts are what keep us going. So those books are my brain. Books represent the stuff that you read. Maybe you forgot it, but it's still in the book, right? It's stuff you could read in the future. You know it exists. It's like potential. Now I have gotten to write my own brain because I've written more than 6 books, Rob, over 20, please. 6, 8, 10, 12, 20, whatever. You know, at a certain point, you do lose count. And so now I get to write my own brain. And over time, these books have been my way of thinking about what is graphic design, who is it for, how can we invite people to participate in graphic design. All of my books are designed to be used and read and like keep it in your bathroom or whatever. They're not precious. They're really supposed to be an invitation to engage in this thing that I love so much. Graphic design and typography, you know, it's amazing. So imagine my joy being in the brain of the Letterform archive, and just the sheer weight of it is just so fantastic. All that nerdy opportunity, like all those books, and they're all about our stuff, right? It's so great. So that's cool. So what I'm gonna do tonight is I'm gonna talk a little bit about one of my recent brain projects, this book and exhibition called The Senses. And I'm gonna talk about a new project that is really just at its beginning point. And I'd love to be in touch with you. I love your ideas about it. It's ideas I'm just kind of starting to work through. So this is a book and exhibition at Cooper Hewitt that was opened in 2018, and that's what the book looks like, by David Genko. Beautiful book design. We worked on it together and kind of brought every page to life. It was super fun. And this is what the exhibition looked like. And it was an exhibition about really exploring graphic design and product design and architecture and experience design and animation as being more than visual, and about how our sense of vision actually communicates with your whole body. It isn't just our eyes, but the sound and touch and smell and taste, all these, and just the way your body feels like moving through space, these all affect how we interact with the world, and it's all part of design. So beautiful exhibition design. You could literally run your fingers through the hair of the exhibition. These kind of flowing walls made out of thread and stuff to smell. These are snowballs infused with the smell of winter. And everyone has a little Christmas bell inside. I mean, it's just so romantic. And, you know, a furry wall that you can pet, and it makes music. A music player that translates sound into vibration so that someone who doesn't hear can experience sound on their skin as vibration. The world's first Braille smartwatch. So it actually gets text messages in Braille, incredible. And people could touch it and actually see it. And things made to be touched and smelled and just interacted with in a physical way with your body. And one of the challenges that we set ourselves, me and my team at Cooper Hewitt, was how can we make this exhibition accessible to everyone? So it's a show about sensory experience, and it should be able to be experienced by anyone coming into the museum, including people with different sensory abilities. And there's a big challenge for museums, because museums tend to focus on vision at the expense of all other senses. I learned so much. So one of the things I learned is the expression eyes free. And how can a museum visitor have an experience that is eyes free? We worked with Sina Barham, who's an incredible designer and computer scientist and consultant to museums about accessibility. And that's Sina having an eyes-free experience. And he really helped us think through this problem and what we could do at the museum. You can read his essay called The Inclusive Museum in our book. And he talks about how museums do a great job getting people with disabilities in the door, right? We have ramps, we have doors that open, we have security guards. But once people get there, we don't care too much about the experience that they have. And museums need to do better, dig deeper to make that great experience. So Sina helped us create a system that included Braille and a number system and an app and descriptions of objects in the show so that a person could find their way through the exhibition and listen on an app to descriptions of what was there, in addition to interacting directly in an immediate way with artifacts. So putting those different senses together, right? Not isolating them, but bringing them together. I'm gonna show you just a little clip from the app that Sina helped us develop. And one of the things I learned from Sina is that when people who are visually impaired listen to audio, they often speed it up, like a lot. And in a sense, they are adjusting the kerning on the audio. And so we can start to think about audio as a user interface.
0406. Vibeat Tactile Audio Device, 2016. Two circular pods are attached to the table. Touch one pod with each hand to feel music as vibration. Vibeat was designed by Liron Gino, a graduate of Jerusalem's Bezalel Academy of Arts and Design, Israel. These jewelry-like pieces are designed to be worn as a bracelet, brooch, or necklace.
Sina would actually listen to it probably four times, not just twice. Like, he likes it really, really fast. It'll be kind of like us reading like six-point type, right? And it makes it an easier way to get a lot of information all at once. So I learned a lot about that. I have another little clip to show you, which is Stevie Wonder at the Grammys in 2016 was one of the presenters. And when he presented, he was given an envelope that had Braille in it. And I want you to watch it, partly because it's beautiful and he has a great message. But I also want you to watch, like, the people around him are afraid he's not going to be able to read the envelope. Like, they really want to help him, but he's got this. It's also really interesting to see how he reads the Braille. And often a blind person is holding the Braille against their body and actually reading it from the bottom up. And so that was really useful for us in our exhibition, just thinking about where to put Braille on exhibits and like what the physical experience of a person is that's different. And you can't just assume it's the same configuration. So I think this is really cool from a number of perspectives. Really beautiful. One of the things I learned, though, doing this exhibition is that fewer than 10% of the 1.3 million people who are visually impaired in the US don't actually read Braille. And that Braille is not like something that every blind person knows. And so we kind of assume that putting Braille on stuff solves all the problems. But actually, you have to do more than that and really understand who your users are and what's going on with them. It was really important to us to use Braille in our exhibition to demonstrate the existence of this non-alphabetic, tactile, accessible language system and to bring that home to every single visitor that existed in the environment. But we also had to do more for our visitors. And one of the things we learned is that visitors who are visually impaired really want a tour with curators. They really want to walk through the exhibition and have somebody talk to them and have a very intimate experience with them. So Cooper Hewitt now has trained every single museum guide to be able to give a tour to someone who's visually impaired. They don't have to make a special appointment and come only on like blind person day, but any tour will be accessible to them. That's a seeing eye poodle, the first ever that I got to meet, an amazing creature. very cool. So it's really important when you're creating accessible design to have lots of different choices. There isn't just one way to solve all the problems. This is my book, Thinking with Type. It is not a PDF. It is a physical book. And when you open it up, it has this thing I wrote like 20 years ago. I said, typography is what language looks like. And as I start working on this exhibition about the senses, I'm like, is that right? Am I leaving people out? Could you have typography that you can't see? Like, are there other aspects of typography? It really made me think when I do my new edition, I gotta come up with a different title page, right? That has like a bigger view of what it is that we do. So maybe not. Maybe that isn't all it is. And what is typography beyond vision? So this is a beautiful book that we made, and it's very tactile. But it is not accessible. And so what do you do about that? And we can say, well, as graphic designers, we're visual artists. Who cares? We don't have to make things accessible to everyone. But I don't think that is good enough. And there's lots of things you can do. So we made an accessible EPUB for our book, which is free. You can download it on the Cooper Hewitt website. And it is accessible. And it's not that hard to do this, to create digital media that's a parallel to your print media. And we had to add visual descriptions to all the captions. It was the only kind of content change we had to make. So that's an accessible book. And I think it's really important that we try to do that in publishing. I think all of you are familiar with closed captions for the hearing impaired. Is anybody here who's not hearing impaired turn on the captions when you watch Netflix? I love it, right? Especially British crime shows. Because I don't think that's English, right? Those people don't talk right. So this is a great effect of creating accessible media, is that actually it benefits a lot of people when you add those captions. And lots of people get more out of media when they can read what's going on the screen. Now, closed captions and open captions are created for people with a hearing impairment. What do you do for people who are visually impaired? Well, there's a solution for that, too, and that's called audio description. And lots of movies and shows on Netflix also have an audio track that you can activate, which is a voice explaining what's happening visually on the screen. This is amazing for everyone too, because suddenly you can watch Netflix while you're driving. Isn't that great? You can actually hear the show and know what the action is. I didn't know about that. So it was so fun for me and such a great challenge to learn all these different aspects of how we communicate. One of the blind museum goers that we talked to said, audio should be a right? This is something that every museum should make available to everybody. So J.J. Hunt is an audio description specialist. This is what he does, and he describes all kinds of content for audiences all around the world. And one of the projects that he did is he created an audio description for Childish Gambino's This Is America. And he took, do people know this video? I'm gonna show you a little clip that doesn't have anything severely violent in it. I'm gonna show you like 30 seconds of it. When this video came out, there was all kinds of interpretation in the press about what it meant and what was going on and what kind of dance moves there were and what the content of it was. So J.J. Hunt made this beautiful audio-described version of the video that took a lot of that interpretation and allows a viewer or listener to hear what's going on screen while seeing it, or if you don't see, to not see it and to just hear it. And on his website, he has this wonderful little user experience thing, which is a slider, which allows the user to turn up that audio description so that it's more or less prominent. So again, a kind of adjustment of the audible typography of the piece. I'm going to play you a little clip of J.J. Hunt's interpretation of this amazing music video.
Gambino sings and dances for us, flashing exaggerated grins like those used by entertainers in blackface. Five black teenagers in school uniforms dance behind him, wearing gleeful expressions. Their moves reference popular African dances, including shoki and guara-guara. The dancing distracts us from what's happening in the background, where people run through the warehouse, some armed with baseball bats, knives, and sticks. They dash between parked or abandoned cars, swinging their weapons. Standing atop a car, a student shoots a red cash can.
So that's audio description, and that's something that now at Cooper Hewitt we add to all of our videos, that we want to make sure they're accessible through multiple forms. So that's pretty cool. So what's happening in my brain now is pretty cool, I think. So I went back to that shelf, my shelf of books in college that was always so proud of all that cool political French stuff that I read. And I was like, oh my God, all of these books were written by white men. And it's not like there were no people of color or no women writing in the 1970s. You know, it was a pretty active time for a lot of stuff to be written. So I'm working on a book with my best friend, Jennifer Tobias, and it's called Extra Bold. And it started out as a feminist guide to graphic design. And then it got bigger. It got to be about more stuff and more inclusive and more diverse in its view of the world. And it's like one part theory, one part self-help, and one part like working in the gig economy. And it's funny and illustrated and it's really interesting. And it's been an opportunity for me to read a lot more stuff and make my brain bigger, which I highly recommend, really opening your brain and finding there's room in there for a lot more ideas. So one of the books I've been reading is Sarah Ahmed, Living a Feminist Life. And I really love this book because it's about feminism as a kind of action and a way of being and moving in the world, and how theory can actually just be part of who you are and what you do. I've been reading Bell Hooks, Feminism is for Everybody. And I love this book because she includes men can be feminists, that we can have new visions of what masculinity is, and that's part of feminism. And that the history of feminism in the US has really been defined and dominated by white women, and that white women have to like step aside and listen and pay attention and not dominate the conversation about feminism. So these books are really, they really make you think. So you know, our book is not a book just for women, it's for everyone. And I know there's a lot of books out there that are like for a specific audience. I found this book in our free bookstore in Baltimore. It's called English for Women. And I was like, well, why would learning English be different? Why do women need their own English book? In the kitchen, at the vanity table, sewing, and love. These are the things that we need to be able to speak English about. And looking inside the book, I can see the importance of that. This is some heavy stuff. Right, and we wonder, what's English for men? What's in their book that's not in our book? And then there's a lot of books for graphic designers that are purportedly for everybody, but have this kind of, I don't know, male bias? I had to look that up, what a wanker is. You know, and these are the interviews in the book. And so some of these books take the point of view that by being for everyone and having this kind of universal point of view, they include everyone, but actually they don't. And so our book takes a little bit of a different attitude and sort of embracing the fact that people come to the subject of graphic design with a lot of different experiences, a lot of different backgrounds. And this is a beautiful book by Craig Oldham. There's just something so bro about it, you know? Oh, shit, what now? And it has this kind of confidence to it that, I don't know, it doesn't invite me in to engage with it. So we're looking at stuff like that and saying, how can we ask slightly different questions? Part of graphic design even existing as a field is about creating standards, right? Like, we are in the norm business. And the idea of creating something universal, it's older than Helvetica, right? The idea of creating something for a kind of normative human being. So this is a diagram of the ideal person created by a German architect in the 1930s. And it's based on like a beautiful white Greek man, right? So we call him Mythical Norm. He's in our book. And Mythical Norm lives inside a whole bunch of bubbles, right? The white bubble, the educated bubble, the English-speaking, able-bodied, Christian, cisgendered, heterosexual, citizen settler, middle class, traditional household. There's a series of bubbles that we, you know, that American society and Western society kind of establishes as the norm. And yet most of us, you know, fail to meet at least one of those bubbles, right? It's hard to actually find the guy that perfectly is all of that stuff. And if we look at the history of typography, we can see a kind of desire to cleanse away ornament and curly cues and feminine things and culturally specific things in favor of something universal, right? Something that's been cleaned up and made into this kind of machine for communication. So that's a diagram by Herbert Beyer about kind of erasing the particular in favor of the universal. And if you think about your experience going to design school, I certainly remember mine, that mine was a lot about learning the idea of consistency and hierarchy and creating grids and creating things that are standard, and the idea of brand guides. The wonderful collection at the Letterform Archive has hundreds of these brand guides that are kind of Bibles of creating normativity for a company. And learning that is like a big part of what we do as graphic designers. It's part of what is part of our discipline, right? It's like, yeah. So when I was in art school, the big daddy of our field was Uncle Massimo, and he was amazing. Like, this was such cool stuff, and you know, fixing the subway so people could actually find their way was really great. And he had all these rules, like what typefaces you were allowed to use. And my students and I talked about this on Sunday at the workshop, but like, this seems now to me so patriarchal, right? There's your five. I picked them, and you use them, okay? So I'm so glad that there's 16 Type West graduates here who have all released a new typeface into the wild to compete with Massimo's five. We need that diversity. This is Kalina Sales, who's a graphic design professor in Nashville, and I talked to her about the idea of norms in graphic design, and she talked to me about how those norms assume a certain kind of cultural background, like who are those norms created for? And her students primarily come from low-income urban neighborhoods, and their vision of what is beautiful, of what is designed, is different from the vision of someone from a wealthy suburb. So she gave me this example, which is someone from a poor neighborhood may not have a neighborhood bank. And they might think of banking as something associated with gold and wealth and bling, whereas someone from a suburban neighborhood might think of this kind of more UI/UX bank, right? The service bank, the bank where you get your housing loan, and not really associating it with extreme wealth. So the norms of graphic design come out of a certain culture. And so I just want us to think about that, right? And have think about critically about what is going on there, the language of typography. There we go. Here's a table from the Letterform archive, set with work by Amos Kennedy Jr. and Emery Douglas and Emigre and 19th century American printing and stuff that Massimo would not have put on the table. But he's in the collection too. And that's good. There's room on the table for lots of different kinds of graphic design. So right there in the middle is a poster by Amos Kennedy, which I really love. And you gotta kind of read it and think about it. And I love the mix of typefaces and the language of it and how it challenges our assumptions about binaries and identity and who God is, which is really cool. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the idea of binaries and graphic design and the essentializing of gender. So we have a little chapter about pregnancy rights, which is one of the still the biggest thing holding women back in the workplace is the high cost of raising children. There's a little story here. He hopes she's not pregnant. And what is she thinking? She hopes he's not pregnant. You can think about that. So that's the cradle of civilization, which turns out is a cradle. That's where civilization comes from. So the idea of challenging gender binaries and the absolute category of male versus female, that philosophical conversation actually originated at Berkeley with the incredible philosopher Judith Butler in her book, Gender Trouble. And I won't go deep into the theory here, but her ideas really helped generations like rethink the notion of an absolute break, an absolute opposition between male and female identity. And we could look at that in typography and think about, you know, feminine style versus masculine style. And we could switch it, right? But that's kind of 101, right? We're so beyond that. I got to thinking about binaries and how essential binary thinking is to typography as I was taught it and as I have taught it to my students. And I started to think about the history of typography as really being about the establishment of these binary categories, Roman italic, uppercase, lowercase, serif, sans serif. Why is this shit so important? Right? Why are these fundamental poles around which we organize typography? And if you look at the history, it is, has not always been so. So early printing, italic, this is from Venice in the late 15th century, italic was just considered a different font that took up less space and had a different origin to it and had this beautiful look, but basically was economical, it saved paper. And the Roman was just added in because the italic didn't have uppercase letters. And it looks kind of beautiful. You get this beautiful contrast between the Roman and italic. But they're not considered like opposites. They're not considered a polarity. But that happened pretty quickly, that typefaces came to be understood as having this binary opposition between Roman and italic. And we just accept that today, right? Serif and sans serif, same thing. Like, what the hell is a serif? Why is it so important that some fonts have them and some fonts don't, right? Like, what, this is this fundamental thing. When sans serif typefaces first started to exist, they were just one thing among many. It wasn't some ideological point of view. It's just some typefaces didn't have that, you know? No big deal. That was the 19th century. And I love looking at studies like John Barry's study of serifs, where he's like, if all those different things can be a serif, is a serif really a thing? Right? If it is so diverse, if it has so many ways of expressing itself in the world, or if a sans serif letter form can be this many things, is that really, you know, is that really a fundamental identity for a typeface? So I find that really interesting. And Rob and I looked through all kinds of beautiful type specimens yesterday and found these crazy typefaces. Like, is that a serif? What is happening? It's like the whole curve of the R is expressing the joy of serifdom, right? It's the whole thing. Look at this. Look at that happiness, right? Look at that. But it's an expression of the being of a letter form that really doesn't conform to that strict binary of serif, sans serif. Or italics that go the other way, you know? Why not? And actually, these binaries have a kind of political element to them. So, for example, bilingual authors now are rejecting the idea that so-called foreign words should be printed in italic, because that's a kind of othering of the native language of the writer. So a writer that is naturally writing in both Spanish and English, or English and French, and putting those words directly into the voices of characters doesn't need to keep othering the language by using italic. I think that's kind of cool. Rejecting uppercase and lowercase, you know, that for Herbert Beyer, for the Bauhaus, for Jan Tschichol, this was political. This was about creating a more democratic alphabet, something that was cheaper, easier to learn, less hierarchical. There is a politics to that. Bell Hooks spells her name in lowercase, and she made her own name based on the name of women in her family. And setting her name in lowercase is kind of proclaiming this everydayness and sort of putting the capitalism back in capital letters, finding the power there. These are some gorgeous examples of the unruly typographic bodies of the 90s. I love the 90s, right? And all these playing with putting different typefaces together to create stuff that really fought the rules, right, and fought the binaries. This is Democratica, a beautiful typeface from 1991 that's monocase. It has no upper and lowercase distinction. And it's called Democratica to be more democratic, right? One alphabet for everybody. And then the final opposition, which is really a big one, is the opposition of black and white. So if we look at amazing books like this from 1499 that integrated illustration and type on a single page, we have illustration being forced into this perfect black line. It's sort of incredible how the woodcut has just the right weight to go with the letter forms. And Rob pointed out to me that this is a very valuable book because it is not censored. And I'm going to show you the part that would be censored. So cover your eyes if you're shy. Okay. Isn't that great? I blushed when I saw this. So the idea of black and white is really interesting in the history of printing, because the invention of printing coincides with the rise of colonialism and the West invading other countries and kind of establishing whiteness as a force of civilization. In printing, we have the elimination of polychrome, which is quite interesting, right, in favor of what the technology favored. There's an incredible article. If you want to read it, you actually have to get the book from a real library. But it's about the racialization of print. And it really traces the idea that white paper and black ink and the obsession that printers had with the purity of white paper was linked to the ideology of whiteness, which was really invented in the Renaissance. It's a really incredible book, an incredible argument about this black-white binary coming out of print, and that typography itself is a kind of enforcement of racial dualism, and the idea you have to be black or white, but there's nothing in between, which we know is not true. And so if you look at typography and the evolution of letter forms and the striving for the absolute crispest, most high contrast characters on the whitest, shiniest, glossiest paper, and think about that as like a moment of so-called modernity in typeface design, and linking it to a kind of ideology of black and white, I think is pretty fascinating. And this writer talks about there were printers in the 19th century who were like, what's all this with white paper? Who cares if it's white? It should feel good. And softer, browner paper is easier on the eyes, you know, and a beautiful book is usually printed on paper that has a little tone to it, right, that isn't that stark white. So it kind of brings us back to touchy-feely, right, to texture, to creating things that are wonderful to touch. So these are the little samples that are in the back of the room. This is Moon Type. It was created by a visually impaired designer, and it was intended to be an alternative to Braille that's easier to learn if you lose your sight later in life. It's arguable. There's a whole theory about that. Look it up. But beautiful artifact that you can look at in the case. Or this book by Irma Boom, who will be here later this month, which has no printing. It is all embossed, and it's a history of the Chanel company. And she felt since Chanel creates a product that you can't really see, it's just a smell, Chanel number 5, why not make a book that you can't see either? And it is really stunning, a stunning and precious thing. And if you make an appointment at the Letterform Archive and wash your hands, you can actually touch this book. You can touch some typography. This is a little bit less friendly. It's by Stefan Sagmeister, and it's all hard edges, so you might hurt yourself. But it's a beautiful piece of 3D printed typography. And then there's just looking at dimension and typographic magic. And when we think about the senses, our eyes, we touch things with our eyes. I can look at these velvet chairs and see with my eyes that they're soft. And our eyes are constantly touching the world around us. And we can create typography that feels good to touch even when it's flat. So I love this. It's so beautiful. It fools the eye. It seduces the eye. It makes the eye feel good. And wow, right? So cool, that dimensionality. And why not add some color while we're at it, and bring back chromatic typography. So what is typography? I'm gonna have to figure that out for the third edition of my book. I have a whole bunch of probably terrible ideas. I don't know, but we have to describe it in an inclusive way that isn't just about looking at stuff, but you can hear a typography, you can touch it. We have to make stuff like that. I love this, what Herb Lubalin said. Typography means different things to different people. And I'll take that for now. It's my placeholder. So thank you very much. And thank you to the archive and the library and to the great brain that lives all around us. So thank you.
I have a question on Braille. Do you think it's possible to change the system and make Braille understandable for people that can read so they can also kind of get a connection between the alphabet and the Braille alphabet?
Well, that's a really interesting question. Sighted people can learn Braille. It's challenging. There are systems for making it easier for a sighted person to learn it. Is that what you mean?
Yeah, I was wondering because I looked at Braille and there could be a way to just change the dots so they kind of reflect the letters that as we have right now. So it will be interesting to just see how Braille could look like so it will be understandable by blind people, but also by people who want to read them.
Yeah, there actually is research on that, and people, there are new versions of tactile alphabets that have been introduced. We had one in our exhibition. It's a really important area because many, many people who are blind become blind later in life, and it's much more difficult for them to learn Braille than for a child. So these hybrid systems like MoonType are intended to perform that. And they're also easier for a sighted person to learn. So it's a good challenge and it's a legitimate one. Yeah.
Okay, let's see another hand.
Oh, let me do her.
Can you keep the hand up?
Oh, great.
I have two questions, actually. When is your book out, the one that was about, like, feminist...
The Extra Bold? Yeah. Extra Bold will come out in fall 2020. Yeah.
Okay. Awesome.
A little over a year. We're, like, 30% through.
I'm looking forward to
hopefully.
It.
Fingers crossed.
And I went to a talk last week that was on gender-neutral design.
Oh, I would love to learn more about that. So I'm really, I want to like hear from people like stuff I should know and so okay. Tell me what you learned.
Yeah, so she talked about, she had a slide up that was very similar to your slide with the masculine and the feminine in both color as well as typography. We're exposed to it at a very young age and our brains kind of start to associate certain colors as well as typefaces with certain genders. And a gender-neutral approach, I don't know if there's a perfect description for it right now, but I guess what I grappled with was in our effort to make everything more inclusive, were we actually like making it less relatable to anyone? So I wanted to hear
like Helvetica.
Yeah.
I guess my feeling is that there's room for all of it, and that the freedom to express a certain gender or no gender at all should be everybody's their decision or what they believe they who they are, and so creating design choices for people that allow all those positions to be expressed is really important. So obviously like bathroom signs is one area, but also fashion, makeup, shoe design, you know, all kinds of areas of design that could be more inclusive and allow all kinds of bodies to take all kinds of expressions. So I'm not so much for erasing gender as just allowing the spectrum of possibilities to be expressed.
Okay, who had a question over here? Okay.
Hi. Thank you for the presentation today. You mentioned kerning in audio, and that got me excited. I'm curious about what other typographical elements are you also seeing in audio, especially as we're seeing a lot more conversational UI? What else are you seeing?
Wow, I guess that's something I'd like to hear from you more. I mean, my experience is more with the audio description and the idea of being able to adjust the soundtrack of what you're listening to either foreground the commentary or foreground the original sound of the art that you're listening to. As well as the, you know, I think a lot of us when we watch instructional videos like speed it up. And the notion that that's actually you should build it into the design of what you create, is that people are gonna mess with your audio. I think it's really great that, you know, on my Kindle, I can change the size of type, right? Or you can choose the dyslexic typeface, or Comic Sans if you want. It's a free country. Why not? So why not also be able to adjust audio? So I'd be curious what you, it annoys me that like Alexa always has the same voice. That should be, I should be able to customize that.
Question in the back. There we go.
Okay, I'm going to be very close and say that I don't actually have a question. I just wanted to follow up on that question about how do we adapt audio. There's been research done in human-computer interaction about how we could convey bold, italic, emphasis, and so on by using different types of voices. So it could be people switching the gender of voices, people using artificial voices instead of natural voices. There's just like a huge amount of experiments around that, but mostly people just want to have audio for like the practical content, and except if you're proposing an experience, like for audio description, like have great audio description to access information, like you don't need that kind of styling. It just doesn't work the same way.
Yeah, apparently, like kids who have you know, Alexa in their house, like yell at her and say like "fuck you, Alexa," because that's so fun, and is perpetuating a way of speaking to a female entity in a disrespectful and kind of violent way. So this idea of changing the voice to not be male or female, and there is like a gender-neutral voice that was created in Sweden. That's really cool. That takes sort of amalgamates several different voices to create one that isn't identifiably male or female. But there really is a political problem, you know, if people are yelling at their assistant like that. Especially kids.
Okay, I got one question here, and then I see one in the back, and then Andrea's gonna give you that, right?
Pretty soon.
Okay, this was published a few weeks ago by AIGA. It was an article about decolonization in design. And what that is just the idea that design is struggling with a crisis where the epitome of design is understood to be what Western and Eurocentric like norms are. And because of colonization and imperialism, all other cultures have been unable to, like, I guess, stand on an equal ground. And I'm curious if, A, you saw that, and B, what your thoughts
are. Yeah, I thought it was
a
really good article. And very accessible and very inviting for anybody to read and kind of get into that conversation about decolonization. And it has great links to all kinds of other stuff. I found it really fascinating and very valid argument.
Okay, in the back.
Thank you for your presentation. So I'm curious, throughout your tenure in design, as you kind of do all the research and take a look at how design has changed throughout the years, is there anything that you find you miss in the current state of design as we, and I'm speaking from like the UI UX bank type of designer, so like very much overcorrecting for pixel perfection and things like that, that you find have been kind of lacking as we very much optimize for this very modern driven type of.
Yeah, I miss the 90s. 1890s. 1990s. Yeah, I think that the sort of Silicon Valleyization of design has created a sort of a friction-free ideal of what design is supposed to be, and it is kind of denuded and often lacking in personality, apart from being like friendly, you know, with cute copywriting. So yeah, I miss there being more friction and surprise and unusual stuff in design. So I'm glad there's going to be a lot more typefaces to play with. That helps, right?
Yeah. And speak.
We have not done that, have not tried to do that. I think the best way to do that is actually through audio and through audio tours that are done in multiple languages, because putting a lot of different languages on the text takes up a huge amount of space. Another way would be to do it with electronic, touchpad museum labels, where you could have more language present. But it is a really important thing, and it's another form of inclusivity and decolonization that museums should be doing more with. And some of that could be solved with technology, because it's about getting enough information in a small space, right? I'm thinking augmented reality, we're there.
Okay, well, thank you very much, everybody. Thank you, Ellen.
Okay, thank you.
And we'll see you back here on August 27th for Irma.